In many places, static caravans enhance the coast. These holiday homes, yes, holiday homes, accentuate the grimness. They fit in with industrial plant, with refineries, cranes, mills and so on, none of which come to any accommodation with the land they're set on.
Is anyone else coming into this spot? Always beautiful.
Statics belong to the English tradition of coastal degradation, of trash architecture and trash arcades, which famously possess a trashy vitality all of their own. It's a vitality whose odour is that of mechanically recovered meat frying in sump oil. A place such as the Isle of Sheppey is unimaginable without its endless static suburbs. Without them, it's mere marsh, fields, estuarial grimness. With them, it's metal Mecca, world and leatherette. The vans have breeze block mini stilts. It's as though district councils fear that the vans are capable of knotting themselves to their sod. The gardens do connect with the earth. They have foundations even if the vans haven't. The aspiration is suburban security, literal roots. That's what the gardens achieve with their little wicket fences and their gnomes and their windmills. But it's not the expression of taste that's the point. And besides, bad taste is better than no taste at all. The point is that these gaudy icons signify ownership and territorial dominion. A tomcat sprays, a static defines its space with doughty guard dogs. Site owners know that statics enjoy a base reputation. They are all too aware of the hostility they provoke in the vanless. Hence the regimentation of these vans and the emphasis on neatness and spruceness. Who is this show of orderliness meant to impress? What are these colours for? What do they signify? The length of the inmate's sentence? Is it green for recidivists and Bobby Sands beige for politicals? Is there a chromatic hierarchy? It's as though the deployment of kit, which looks as though it was intended for a penal institution, is reckoned to proclaim the strict regime of the site. Statics are Sheppey's main industry. The insular microeconomy depends on them. The next biggest industry actually is incarceration. And many ex-cons stay on, make their home in Sheppey among the tribe of the whites. The guys with white cars, white string vests, white socks, white skin. After Tronc, statics certainly do spell freedom. Now they can eat horrible grub, they can slop out, they can live in uncomfortable proximity to each other. The English enjoy nothing better than to gather their cars in a field. They're like the Sioux with their teepees. It's conceivable that the popularity of car boot sales has little to do with an appetite for bargains. This is a mere excuse for a gathering, an opportunity to partake in metal communion.
Come on, on that line.
Timmy, on that line, on that line. The appetite of the Middle English male for directing traffic is boundless. Come on, come on, bags of room there. Come on, easy now, easy. You sometimes get the impression that we're a nation of lollipop men monkey, of aspirant traffic policemen, of troops directing amphibious landings. She's there.
Tourist sites are magnets for victims of this perversion, which disguises low-level authoritarianism as helpful matiness. The ne plus ultra of this kink is the reversing competition. This is the arcane rite of profound caravanning. It's also the Terpsichorean end of caravanning, a sheet metal pavan. Been a caravanner rather than a camper, this is an area in which he would have excelled. You simply can't do this with a tent.
And Jim Moore.
Whatever the activity, tourers do it in public, in full view of their fellow vansters. All caravanners are infected by the germ of nakedness. They're RAW positive. Tourers rarely sport net curtains. Net curtains are for statics. With a tourer, the lack of privacy is sacrosanct. You want to be seen.